A 60-year-old male patient presented to the emergency department with acute onset of left-sided hemiparesis. This is his CT scan. Look at this CT scan. What are the imaging findings in this case? What is the diagnosis? If you can't answer the questions, then this video is for you. Welcome to Radio Clinics. Today's topic is CT imaging of ischemic infarction. Ischemic stroke results from a sudden cessation of adequate amounts of blood reaching parts of the brain. Stroke is the second most common cause of morbidity worldwide after myocardial infarction and the leading cause of acquired disability. An ischemic stroke typically presents with rapid onset neurological deficit, like in our case, which is determined by the area of the brain that is involved. After detailed clinical examination, the first investigation that we do in case of acute stroke is usually a CT scan or a MRI scan. What are the features in acute stroke? If the patient presents after 24 hours and within 1 week, which is the usual scenario, then it is known as acute stroke. In acute stroke, the findings in imaging in a CT scan of head are presence of triangular or wedge-shaped hypodensity. Hypodensity means that the area involved should be less dense than the adjacent brain parenchyma, and it should be triangular or wedge-shaped. The next criteria is that it should involve both gray and white matter. For example, in this case, we can see that there is hypodensity noted in the left frontal and temporal lobe. This hypodensity is wedge-shaped and is also involving both gray and white matter. So if we see that this is the white matter of the right cerebral hemisphere, similarly in the left cerebral hemisphere, this is the white matter, and the part outside the white matter is the gray matter. So this hypodensity has involved both gray and white matter, and this is a case of acute stroke. If the patient presents after 1 week and before 3 weeks, then it is known as subacute stroke. In subacute stroke, the swelling of the brain subsides and there may be areas of petechial and guidiform hemorrhages. One specific sign which may occur in case of subacute stroke is known as the fogging sign. Fogging phenomena is seen in a non-contrast CT of the brain, and it represents a transient phase of evolution of an infarct where the region of cortical infarction regains a near normal appearance. So in our previous case, which was a case of acute stroke in the left frontal lobe, this was the finding in day 2, which is the acute phase. But later on day 7, the area of hypodensity in the left frontal lobe has disappeared. This disappearance of hypodensity is known as the CT fogging sign. In another case, at day 8, this patient presented with these findings. The findings consist of hyperdense area in the right frontoparietal region. So we can see that the hyperdensity is gyriform in appearance. So it resembles the gyri. This gyriform hyperdensity is consistent with hemorrhagic transformation of an infarct, and it is seen in case of subacute infarct. We can also see mass effect with effacement of the right lateral ventricle. The right lateral ventricle is smaller in size compared to the left lateral ventricle. What happens in a chronic stroke? After 3 weeks, edema subsides and volume loss of the brain parenchyma takes place. When there is volume loss of the brain parenchyma, the sulci appear prominent. So this is the sulci, it appears prominent. The ventricles appear prominent. In acute and subacute stroke, there is some mass effect. But in contradiction to those findings, in chronic phase, there is volume loss. And with volume loss, the ventricles appear enlarged. And the infarcted region of the brain becomes more hypodense in nature and resembles the CSF ultimately. So in this case of chronic infarct, we can see hypodense area in the previous area of infarct, and this hypodensity resembles like that of CSF of the ventricle, and we can also appreciate volume loss in the form of dilatation of the ipsilateral lateral ventricle compared to the right side. This is a case of chronic stroke. This phenomena is known as encephalomalacia. In another case of a patient who presented previously with right basal ganglia infarction, now the chronic changes are hypodense area in the right basal ganglia. This hypodense area resembles attenuation of the CSF. Also, the adjacent sylvian fissure is prominent. Compare the right sylvian fissure with the left sylvian fissure, and you can see that the right sylvian fissure is quite prominent compared to the left side. These are all the features of volume loss, and these features of volume loss are consistent with chronic stroke. What happens if the patient presents in less than 24 hours? If the patient presents in less than 24 hours, then this case is known as a hyperacute infarction. Hyperacute infarction are quite difficult to diagnose on CT scan. There are subtle signs in case of hyperacute infarction. One of them is known as the hyperdense MCA sign or hyperdense vessel sign. MCA means middle cerebral artery. In hyperdense MCA sign, we can appreciate clotting in the vessel. So if there is clot inside the vessel appears hyperdense. Like in this case, we can see hyperdensity in the right middle cerebral artery, and this is a hyperdense MCA, which might be the earliest feature for hyperacute infarction. There is also another sign which is known as loss of insular ribbon. Insular cortex is the area of the brain that lies beneath the sylvian cistern. We can see that this is the sylvian cistern of the brain, and this part is the insular cortex of the brain. So we can appreciate that the insular cortex consists of the outer core of gray matter, which appears hyperdense, and the inner core of white matter, which appears relatively hypodense. So we can see that this part is the gray matter of the insular cortex, and this is the subinsular white matter. But in the right side, this insular differentiation of the cortex is lost, and we can see that the insular cortex appears hypodense. So if we compare the right insular cortex with the left insular cortex, we can see that the right sided insular cortex is hypodense compared to the left side. So this is known as the insular ribbon sign. We can appreciate the insular ribbon sign even in this case. Look at the attenuation of the cortex, it is relatively hyperdense compared to the white matter. So here in the insular cortex, which lies beneath the sylvian cistern, we can see that the attenuation of the cortex hyperdense compared to the white matter. But in the right side, the attenuation of the cortex is similar to the white matter. So this is known as the insular ribbon sign, and this is a feature of hyperacute infarction. Another feature of hyperacute infarction is obscuration of the basal ganglia. So we can see that this part in the left side is the lentiform nucleus, which appears lens-shaped. But in the right side, we can't appreciate the lentiform nucleus. So this is known as the obscuration of the lentiform nucleus or obscuration of the basal ganglia. And this is also a feature of hyperacute infarction. So these are subtle signs in case of the hyperacute infarction, which can be identified only if we keep our focus on these signs. Sometimes in case of an early hyperacute infarction, we may not be able to see any changes in a CT scan. In such case, MRI has a role. So in this patient who presented with left-sided hemiplegia, there were no findings in the CT scan. But in the diffusion-weighted MRI, we can see hyperintensity in the left cerebral hemisphere. This patient presented to the emergency room in 1 hour of his weakness, and MRI could pick the findings which was not picked by the CT scan. And MRI has significantly higher sensitivity and higher specificity in the diagnosis of ischemic infarction in the first few hours after onset. By looking at the features in a diffusion weighted MRI, we can plan for thrombolysis or mechanical thrombectomy. These procedures have been found to be useful in earliest stroke presenting up to 6 hours, which only MRI would be able to diagnose. There are certain differential diagnoses of acute stroke which are also fairly common. One of them is vasogenic edema. Vasogenic edema is characterized by finger-like projections in the white matter. So we can see the finger-like projections in the left frontal white matter, and this is a case of vasogenic edema. In contrary to the stroke, the vasogenic edema don't involve the gray matter, but stroke involves both gray and white matter. Vasogenic edema is usually a sequelae of abscess or underlying tumors or metastasis in the brain. So if we see vasogenic edema, we should do a contrast study which can easily find the cause of the edema by enhancing with contrast. And next differential diagnosis for acute stroke is a low grade glioma, but usually a low grade glioma has a prolonged history, so we should also focus on the history of the patient before we look at the imaging findings. In low grade glioma, there are certain features like the heterogeneity of the mass. So this mass, which was proven to be a case of low grade glioma, was heterogeneous in contrast to stroke, which means that it has area very low density, which resembles the CSF, high density, which resembles the cortex, areas of intermediate density, which resembles the white matter. These heterogeneous features distinguish low grade glioma from an infarct. However, sometimes if you are confused in differentiating these features, you can do a MRI scan. MRI can easily differentiate stroke from a low grade glioma because stroke appears as hyperintensity on a diffusion weighted MRI. So coming to our case, in this CT scan we can see there is loss of the insular ribbon on the right side, with insular cortex appearing hypodense, and there is also obscuration of the right basal ganglia compared to the left side. So this was a case of right-sided hyperacute infarction. Thank you.